In 1542, Nicolaus Copernicus was lying on his deathbed, inside the same room he had spent the last 30 years of his life, contemplating the motion of the stars. In his hands, he held a copy of a book, his book, on the revolution of the heavenly spheres, the first and last he would ever publish. Through its pages, it described a groundbreaking idea that the Earth was not the center of our universe, but rather circles around the Sun together with the rest of the planets. And apart from this revolutionary idea, two things stand out. First, that it was independently discovered 2,000 years before his time by a man called Aristarchus. And second, that for Copernicus to come up with his theory, he didn't even have to add a single data point to the Greeks' observations. Aristarchus was an astronomer who was part of a noble lineage, for he was a Pythagorean and last of his line. Before him, Heraclitus had suggested that Venus and Mercury circled around the Sun. And before him, another member of his school was the first to ever suggest that the Earth moves. But first in this great lineage was Pythagoras himself. He might have never placed the Sun at the center of our universe, but nonetheless laid the foundations for most of what followed. Pythagoras was born on the island of Samos around the year 570 BC. A whole century before Socrates, and was said to have packed in his lifetime what is usually contained in 10 or even 20. Because what he achieved was nothing short of a miracle, to unite all knowledge, scientific as well as religious, into one single system of thought. Oh, and by the way, he also coined the term for such a system, one that is still in use today, philosophy. During his time, the island of Samos was ruled by Polycrates, an enlightened tyrant who promoted commerce, piracy, engineering, and the fine arts. Some of the greatest minds of the 6th century before Christ gathered to his court, and Pythagoras grew in a cultural environment that for its time was comparable to that of Paris during the French Enlightenment. After leaving his island home and traveling extensively throughout Greece and Asia, Pythagoras settled in southern Italy, then a vibrant part of the Greek world. There, he founded the Pythagorean Brotherhood, a half-scientific, half-mystical school that made the first steps towards a unified view of the world, a universe. One of his most important discoveries, and in many ways the beginnings of modern science, was that the pitch of a musical note depended on the length of the string which produced it, and that the sequence of ratios, such as 2 to 1, 3 to 2, 4 to 3, produced a musical scale. To better understand why this was so important, let's remember that since the dawn of culture, mankind has been trying to understand the relationship between what is real and what appears to be to the senses. The relationship between ine and phaineste, between what is and what appears to be. In this context, what Pythagoras showed is that qualities such as sound can be reduced to quantities, like the length of a guitar string, binding the subjective world of the senses to the objective world of number. Music, then, is nothing but mathematics for the senses, and the pleasure we get by listening to our favorite melody is just a foreshadow of the pleasure, the ecstasy even, that philosophers can reach by understanding the hidden order that lies behind everything. According to Pythagoras and his students, these sacred ratios existed also in the distances between the planets and the center of their orbits, with the radius of their circles being something like strings of different length, each producing a note, while together a symphony, the entire universe becoming a harp of sublime perfection. This music was inaudible to the common man, but to the philosopher, trained in understanding its secrets, it came to be known as the music of the spheres. And so, the only thing left for the members of the Brotherhood to achieve that ecstasy was to unlock the secret revolutions of the heavenly bodies, the stars. And it was through this almost mystical pursuit of transcendence that Pythagoras and his students would finally reach some of their most unexpected conclusions. The first to break away from the old model that saw the Earth as the center of the universe was Philolaus, a direct student of Pythagoras, who proposed a theory that is at one time close and far from our modern understanding. Because what Philolaus suggested was that all planets, the Earth included, moved around a central fire. That fire, however, was not the Sun, but something else entirely, the Sun being merely a prism that reflects it towards the Earth. A strange theory indeed, but let us not forget that more than 2,000 years later, Copernicus did not believe the Sun to be the center of the universe either. Rather, he thought that a mathematical center existed close to it, and around which both the Earth and the Sun revolved. What is more important, however, in both of these theories is that they put the Earth in motion, displacing it from its position as the immovable center and turning it into a planetis, a planet, which in Greek means wanderer. Next in line came Heraclides, who apart from Pythagoras also studied under Plato and Aristotle, retaining, however, the theories of his brotherhood concerning the motions of the planets. Pythagoras was the first to observe that the star called Phosphorus, rising with the sun each morning, and the one called Hesperos, setting at the sun's tail, was in fact the same planet, Venus. What Heraclides did then was to take this observation to its logical conclusion, that if this planet is always seen following the sun, it must be circling around it. Heraclides didn't go as far as placing the Earth in the same orbit, but made the first decisive move towards it. These theories must have sounded strange enough to win him the name of paradoxologos, one who speaks through contradictions, and would be criticized by later authors for daring to go against his other teacher, Plato. But these accusations were not uncommon, as even during the founder's lifetime, the Brotherhood of Pythagoras would be persecuted, their schools burned, and their master himself murdered. His students, however, never gave up, and moving from one place to the other, like wandering vegan scientist monks, they developed and further spread the ideas of their master, until they inseminated the entire Greek world, and ours as a consequence. And so, we end where we started, with Aristarchus, the last of the Pythagoreans, and first to postulate that all planets, the Earth included, might be circling around the Sun. It was said that Aristarchus was born the same year that Heraclides died. The date might be symbolic, meaning that one followed where the other left off. But believe it or not, it's something of a tradition with great astronomers, as in recorded history, Newton was also born the year that Galileo died. In the case of Aristarchus, and regardless of its factual truth, the date also attests to the Pythagorean Brotherhood's success in keeping alive a line of thinking that ran parallel to the mainstream of Greek philosophy, and maintain the original ideas of Pythagoras concerning the movements of the planets, even when these came in sharp contrast with the more accepted views of their times. Aristarchus wrote a book called On the Sizes and Distances of the Sun and Moon, where he proposed the idea of a solar system, an idea that would be lost and rediscovered 2,000 years later by Copernicus. What is just as surprising as the theory itself, however, is that Aristarchus found no students to teach. In the centuries to come, and while Pythagoras' theories slowly entered the mainstream, his cosmology in particular died with Aristarchus and was to be replaced during Hellenistic times by a system so complex that many of us would consider it an affront to human intelligence. For the next 2,000 years, no real progress would be made, to such an astonishing degree, no less, that from Aristarchus to Copernicus, there is only one single step of logic needed. And it was a step of logic indeed, as Copernicus' revolutionary theory was based on the same data that was available to the Greeks. In fact, and throughout his life, this Polish astronomer rarely even looked at the night sky to confirm any of his ideas, but relied almost exclusively on the data provided by his Greek forebears, the ones who had denied the heliocentric universe using the same data. This piece of history seems puzzling, as it suggests that truth, once found, can also be forgotten, and with no clear reason as to why, as there is no evidence that Aristarchus was even persecuted for his ideas. But let's not kid ourselves. Scientific theories have repercussions far beyond their narrow domains of knowledge. Darwin's theory of evolution, for example, and apart from offering a way to understand the forms of different animals, did something far greater. It showed that, unlike the story of Genesis that we find in the Holy Bible, man was never made perfect to begin with, but slowly evolved towards what he is today from lower life forms. Likewise, Aristarchus' idea that the Earth was not the center of the universe, as provable as it might have been even in his time, also held the power of leaving humanity on the sidelines, its best achievements being secondary, destroying the only claim to immortality the Greeks were allowed to make. Immortality through great deeds and great words. And that is why Copernicus, who used the same crude instruments as the Greeks, could surpass them, because their culture about the importance of human deeds had steadily declined through the rise of Christianity. And perhaps this was also why the Greeks, with their insistence on great deeds and great words, decided to keep the earth and everything on it where it always was, at the center of everything.